Do you ever feel like life is caving in around you? The chaos we feel at work, in our personal moments, the worries of the future, the pain of our present, the baggage of our past, drowns us in emotional turmoil. Hi, my name is Sheng, and I help people and organizations think through their toughest problems. I'll confess that I've been really stressed lately. I've been working nonstop for the last 6 months on my business, growing my team, content output, and building my online community. There's been tons of challenges in all of these areas. And most recently, AI's got me wondering if I'll be replaced soon. The picture is far from perfect, but it's also very human, and that's life. I knew I needed to mind map everything out. Otherwise, I'll never be able to untangle the chaos and continue to just be paralyzed by uncertainty and indecision. So today, I'm sharing with you exactly how I did that. Before I begin, I want to remind you that mind mapping is about taking on the mindset of deconstruction in systems thinking. It's effective because everything, no matter how complex, can be broken down into its simpler parts that we can then manage more effectively with less stress. That includes our personal worries. At the same time, we have to keep the whole picture in mind. As you'll see in my example, I start off by separating personal from professional. But by the end, I have a complete, holistic view of how everything is connected. This is critical to truly understanding our life's chaos and crafting an action plan to deal with it. Today, I'll walk you through the overall steps I took and the final result and conclusions. But if you're interested in how I put this together from scratch, be sure to check out this Map With Me video. All right, we got a lot of cover. Let's hit it. All right, so let's start with the template. What I like to do before mind mapping everything is actually to ask, what question am I trying to answer? In this case, it's, what am I worried about? And then I write this question in the middle of the page, draw a box around it, and that's what's called the central node. I then expand out in subnodes all the different major categories that go into the question. So in this case, it's personal and professional, which for the most part will capture probably the vast majority of the different things that most people are worried about, right? And then I have the other category, which is kind of a bit of a catch-all, since the advantage of having a mind map is that we can actually just jot down non-linearly whatever comes to mind onto this piece of paper, right? We don't have to worry about the sequence, when it happens, what the priority is. If it's on our mind, just put it down. And then finally, I've got factors. So these are more like reminders, values, routines, and stuff like that, that aren't exactly worries, but they can actually affect what's on my mind, what's on my plate. All this is gonna make a lot more sense as we go through the example. So before we dive into that, let me give you a sense of the three steps going from mapping out all of our different worries to actually crafting an action plan to address them. So step one is to expand out all the different elements. And don't worry if this looks like super complicated or overwhelming. We're gonna go through each of these in detail in the next section. All right, by expanding all the different elements, we actually have a bird's eye view of everything that goes into, let's say, professional, personal, other, and then factors. Because unless we put everything down on paper, it's still gonna be in our brain. So we gotta offload it to even start that process of de-stressing and untangling chaos so we can start addressing each of these different components. Once we've expanded out all the complexities and elements, the next step is to map out and expand out the solutions and connections. So you'll notice for this step, I like using a different color pen just to have some contrast so it doesn't look like it's one big mess. So all the red essentially is expanding out the solutions that come to mind that can address each of these subcomponents. You also notice that I got a bunch of arrows going to and from all these different nodes, and it's because I'm trying to understand how are these things connected. The biggest problem with addressing worries is that sometimes, you know, everything just seems to be one big bundle of mess. So by slowing things down, expanding out the complexities, and then drawing the connections between them, we start understanding some causes and effects relationships, but also seeing if there are any feedback loops. And this is what I call having a holistic or whole understanding of the larger picture, which will then help us prioritize which parts of this map do we want to cover first. Because sometimes we're going to discover that there are certain actions that we can take that will have an outsized effect on the rest of our worries. And then the third and last step is to actually create a new mind map that mirrors what we've already made. And this one is far cleaner than the first one. I like to use multiple mind maps as part of a distillation process. The first map that I make is just, you know, putting in the entire mess of things in my life that comes to mind that's making me stressed, worried, fearful, anxious, whatever it is. And then after I have all the elements laid out, the connections and the annotations, I then can make a new map that is essentially representative of the insights that I got from the first one. This is where I can put down next to each of my areas of worry, the different solutions, as well as a timeline. For example, do I want to implement some of these actions this week, next week, or later this month? So by the end of this 2 mind map and 3-step process, I have a much better idea of the nature of my worries, how they're all connected to each other, as well as having an action plan with a timeline that I can start addressing them.
If you are finding this video helpful so far, I would really appreciate a like or even a subscribe to this channel, because I would literally not be doing what I'm doing without your support. All right, let's get back into it.
Let's start with step number 1. Expanding the elements. So here, under professional, I've got AI, right? So the recent developments in AI actually really made me take pause, because I'm a content creator. I write newsletters, I make videos, and now ChatGPT can essentially write like a pretty decent blog in like 5 seconds. So when that first came out, I feel inherently threatened, right? So I was going like, hey, you know, am I gonna get displaced? And there was a lot of angst that was attached to it. Not only that is, if I'm going to learn how to use these things, I have to put in the effort to climb that learning curve. There's also Mind Map Nation, the online community that I created for connective thinkers and mind mappers. So we've actually grown 3x in the last like 3 months since we've launched, which is great news. But at the same time, when a community gets large enough, there's definitely gonna be what's called churn, or people dropping off after the monthly subscription is over. So part of that is definitely affecting me, and I'm wondering why that is, right? I'm looking for feedback from the community, so to understand why they are using mind maps, why they joined the community in the first place. Then there's my team that I had built up over the last 2 months in order to support all my content creation endeavors, right? So a lot of that is actually managing our content pipeline. Am I giving my teammates enough work? You know, videos, publishing, newsletters, and all that. Am I being a good boss, right? So anyways, these are like different thoughts that go through my head. And then there's social media, which is the distribution of all my content. I just started TikTok. Am I doing it right is the major question. Then there's YouTube with the subscriber growth, which I started the year with, you know, some targets I want to hit by the end of this year. But then my growth isn't happening as quickly as I expected. So there's some worry attached to that as well. And then finally, there's a content creation system that I am building to support all of these. And there's actually 2 new components that's upcoming that I still need to build. The first one, for all the productivity nerds out there, is a second brain or external brain software, which is essentially like Roam, Obsidian, and Logseq. These are basically connective thinking note-taking apps that act as a personal knowledge management system. So I bought a course on one of the programs, Logseq, and I have to put in the time essentially to learn the tool. And then there's also the podcast that I've been on the fence for the past year, which I'm finally going to be launching later in the next couple months. And then, so that's why I put a question mark around launch. You know, when is that gonna happen, right? So that's basically all the professional stuff. On the personal side, expanding everything out is health. So I already know that I have acid reflux. What I just found out last week from my doctor is that I have both high blood pressure and high cholesterol, which honestly, given my family history, it shouldn't be a surprise. But for somebody who always saw myself as a healthy individual without any real symptoms and stuff like that, it definitely still came a bit as a shock. And it also forces me to really revisit my lifestyle, specifically around eating and diet. And if I don't get that treated, then it really increases my risk of both a heart attack and stroke. So yeah, just a little bit worrisome. And then there's another thing that kind of came up. In the same week, Olivia found out that she might be moving to Los Angeles for work. So suddenly that move away from San Francisco came onto the radar, right? It wasn't completely out of the blue, but at the same time, you know, I now have to think about timeline, logistics, as well as all the things I want to do in this amazing city before I move away. Finally, there's relationships, which for me, top of mind is my marriage with my wife, Olivia. And this whole month has actually been quite difficult for us because she just moved from an hour south of here to San Francisco. And with any new living situation and all just like so much of the movement, we've also been doing a lot of social stuff with friends. We haven't had a lot of stillness. So we both feel a bit frayed at the edges. And because of that, there's a lot of abrasive energy between the two of us, which is contributing to more conflicts, arguments. So in some ways, that is definitely weighing down on my psyche and emotional health as well. Not only that, her birthday was actually just passed, and I'm still working on the second part of her present. So even though these are not necessarily, you know, bad thing or something to be worried about, it is something that I additionally have to do. And when our plate is already full or our cup is already full, even things that are typically not worries suddenly become additional points of stresses, right? So it's important to actually just list out everything that is on our plate. And then there's others, like friends, community, and then finding balance between fun versus growth. And I put here boundaries. And it's because I feel like I haven't drawn healthy enough boundaries in the last couple of weeks. I felt pretty imbalanced from a social standpoint that I've been kind of, you know, pulled in so many different directions. And I put fun versus growth here is because, you know, I still want to have a social life, but at the same time, I am doing so much on the professional side. And my relationship with Olivia is suffering because of the different, you know, types of worries and stresses that's already on our plate. And this is where I'm like beating myself up for not drawing better boundaries and finding better balance. Finally, there's other. This is like a catch-all category for whatever comes to mind. So for me, it's actually finances, specifically that tax season is around the corner. And it's the first time that I'm gonna be filing my taxes as both a company and an individual. And this is not necessarily something that is traditionally worrisome. I just need to invest that time in order to figure that out and maybe get an accountant to help me. Zooming out a little bit, we've got factors, right? So remember that factors isn't exactly points of worry, but these are almost like important reminders that we should have. They're the context around our lives that either hinder us or support us in all these other areas. So the things under factors for me is routine, which is super important for my productivity, managing my stress and everything, right? Specifically having a good morning routine as well as an evening routine here. If I don't have that, I am a hot mess most of the time. And then speed matters, especially when it comes to actually being responsive to my community, specifically doing all these event summaries that we have on a weekly basis, and then frequency. So frequency on content creation, TikTok especially, is actually extremely important, right? Guard my focus as well as stillness. These two things are essential to my mental and emotional health and productivity. If I don't have this, I'm gonna be pulled in a gazillion ways, especially given all the stuff that I'm working on. And then there's nonlinear growth. So remember how I said that like YouTube or social media isn't growing as fast as I expected? Well, both these things are actually nonlinear in nature, right? It's a hit-based type of thing where one video that goes viral can make a difference for the entire account. So this is something to remind me to not freak out when I only see linear growth rather than exponential growth. Finally, less is more. If I'm gonna be moving to LA, I need less stuff. And just in general, I think having less things in my life is actually better for my productivity and health in general. So all these things are just reminders of what truly matters to me and how these things can actually support me while I'm tackling all these other areas. Okay, so now that we've expanded all the different elements out, it's time to look at the different solutions and connections between these elements. I like using a different color in order to provide some more contrast to the mind map so that it doesn't just become a tangled mess, right? These are actually the solutions as well as the connections between the elements. So let's dive into this one at a time, just really quick. So for example, under AI, I actually put lean into change, right? This is just a reminder that, hey, the only way to actually deal with this change, because AI is not gonna change. It's not gonna go away. It's gonna be a trend that's here to stay. So I might as well lean into that change. The other one I put is Andy Warhol, because fundamentally as a creator, I see myself as an artist. And Andy Warhol was one of the artists that actually used machines to create some of his art. He was actually more of a director. So part of this was actually reminding me that, hey, I can actually use machines as another tool. For example, AI is just another tool. Then I have to learn how to use it. For example, Otter AI, which is a transcription AI service, I can actually use that to summarize some of the timestamps for MyMap Nation, the community. They'll actually make me more efficient. And a big part of the worry that I had was around automation and displacement specifically. So here, I just acknowledge the fact that when AlphaGo beat the Go Grandmaster in the game, the Grandmaster actually up and quit. That was kind of the degree of loss of purpose. And I don't want to go there. I'd rather be Rick Rubin, who is a producer for a lot of award-winning musicians. And he wrote a book called The Creative Act. He writes about how he just really leans into change. That art never gets really displaced. You just learn new tools to become more creative. So if change is happening, then I might as well take advantage of it and ride it. So for AI, it's really number one, mindset shift, and then number two, learning how to use the tool. Those are the solutions. And then MyMap Nation, figuring out what's happening with the churn or why people are leaving, then it's about asking feedback. Earlier this week, I actually wrote a bunch of posts as well as surveys to ask, how can we make the community better? What were your expectations when you joined MyMap Nation? What kind of mind mapping topics are interesting to you? At the end of the day, it's about trying to understand what matters to people. The other thing that I want to remind myself here is user retention or keeping people within the community is a lot cheaper than user acquisition or getting new members. So even though MyMap Nation is still growing in aggregate, I really want to figure out and do the best for our current members. As for my team, it's really about figuring out the right system and roles to assign them. And often part of that is actually batch processing, which is, you know, giving them stuff on a timely basis so that they can actually crank away without last minute, hey, just do this, right? That's gonna stress them out. Social media wise, you know, I'm asking myself, do I wanna restart my account on TikTok? And for YouTube, I'm starting to recognize that the idea of my videos is so, so critical. It all starts with a good idea. And then for that, you know, I don't wanna create in isolation, right? I want to create things that are actually valuable for you guys. So in many ways, asking for feedback from MyMap Nation will also give me better ideas for YouTube. That's actually the solution coming from essentially MyMap Nation. Again, that's why I drew an arrow essentially from MyMap topics and prompts over to YouTube. As for my content creation system, there's the second brain component, the personal knowledge management. That's really just learning how to use these tools again. So prioritize 2 days this week in order to actually sit down, go through the course and start using it. And once I have this, I put numbers and I put a number here, 1 and 2, because there's a priority. I first have to build the platform to store all my learnings in order to make my podcast more productive, because then it feeds into my second brain, which then will feed into more content. So all these different arrows on the professional side is actually a bit of a flow, right? This is what I call a feedback loop, because one thing actually feeds into another that then fuels some of the other components of the system. For example, once I get the volume of content up, that means it increases the likelihood of my YouTube channel growing, which then actually feeds back into more growth for MyMap Nation. Because once you find feedback loops, it's about figuring out which one action is gonna give you the most impact on all the other areas of your concerns. So that means my top priority in the next 2 weeks should actually be really gathering that feedback as well as building up my second brain. And that's why I put here prioritize 2 days this week to actually learn how to use this new tool. Let's zoom out again. Let's go on to the personal side. So on the health side, I drew out diet. Well, because all these things, acid reflux, high blood pressure, and cholesterol, they're all food related. It's just literally years of crappy eating that got me to this place, which is actually good because that actually gives me a single point of improvement. So part of it is actually adopting a Mediterranean diet, which is less snacking, less fat, more fiber, less processed food, and less sugar. Another aspect of it is actually meal prepping so that I'm not tempted to just like DoorDash something. As well as reducing my reliance on coffee and drinking more tea, because coffee doesn't help with acid reflux. But also when I drink coffee, I typically add creamer, and that doesn't really help with the fat aspect either. As for the move from San Francisco to LA, the timeline I really determined, okay, end of May, right? The timeline itself actually doesn't matter so much as how many months I have before I leave. So what I like to do when I'm encountering a big project, let's say like a multi-city move, is actually not think in terms of all the different logistical things, but actually think about how much time do I actually have. I'm going to move at the end of May. That gives me 3 months. What that means is I have 3 months to accomplish a lot of these things before I move. I can actually set up my second brain, my podcast, solidify my content creation system, as well as processes for my team, get my Mind Map Nation to a good place so that I am ultimately ready for that move. That's what 3 months buys me. And then under logistics, have, okay, stuff, housing, the actual move, like trucks and vans and stuff like that. Under stuff, I've expanded out, what do I want to keep, sell, donate, and store. So all this can actually be its own map. But the fact that I've actually broken out the subcomponents makes me feel far less anxious about the move. Because otherwise, it's just like something that's looming in the horizon. I don't have a timeline. I don't have a plan. I don't even know the individual steps. So by breaking this out, that brings me so much more peace because I can now craft a plan around each of these components. Even the bucket list, like, you know, what kind of places do I want to visit? People I want to see, activities that I want to do in the San Francisco Bay Area before I move away from here. Then under relationships, specifically my marriage with Olivia, this is signing up for couples therapy that we're going to be starting later next week. This allows us to have designated time to resolve issues. So it's not just a case-by-case stop and go basis. That means we're actually able to live our lives generally and then have a single time with a third party to actually work those things out with a professional. And along with that is actually a sense of humility. It's actually recognizing that, hey, we're going through a rough patch. And that's usually the first step to actually mending a relationship. And then, of course, the birthday gift I want to finish today. I'm going to carve out some time after I finish this recording. Then there are boundaries. It's about communication, right? So for example, if my friends invite me to go out with them on Friday night, but I'm pretty tired from the entire work week, and I also want to spend some quality time with Olivia, then it's about just saying no. It's about protecting my focus, guarding my routines and my stillness so that it gives me that time and focus. Another thing that I actually put here is meditation. This is so important in many aspects of my life where it alleviates the abrasive energy that I feel with Olivia, and it helps me focus on my work as well as ensures that I have pockets and moments of stillness on a daily basis in order to just defrag my mind. What about finances? Well, tax season, company, individual. This is really just about carving out 2 days out of the next month to try to figure out, all right, what do I actually need to do? Manageable. But at the same time, I needed to list that out as an item. Otherwise, it's just going to be in the back of my head and causing me more stress and anxiety. You also notice that I drew an arrow from the second brain, you know, daily learning to personal, because it is fulfilling for me to actually learn and know that my knowledge and my wisdom is actually accumulating over time. That basically covers most of the solutions and connections. If I want to go even deeper, sometimes I'll actually take a third color pen. That's when you know things are needing even more clarification, and something like, you know, worries kind of deserves that level of detail. I'll take a green pen, for example, and then start actually drawing circles and stars around the things that are like truly, really, really critical. And then making even more connections between, let's say, personal and professional. So for example, routine is absolutely key. This essentially means that, hey, I can actually make my team more efficient by scheduling creation so that they can actually work on these things without being distracted and scattered, right? And then we also have, as I mentioned, having 3 months essentially means that I can work on all these different other professional aspects to get myself on a solid point before I make that move. Also, I put here is exactly 2 years in San Francisco. So that's actually something pretty special to me. That's like a milestone that I spent basically like 2 to 3% of my life in this amazing city. Not only that, 3 months also gives me a chance to solidify my diet so that I'm actually on a strong point in my health by the time that I move to a new city. Mainly because I know that when massive change and turbulence and chaos happens, sometimes all my routines and diets gets like thrown out the window. The other thing about having a routine is, you know, if I'm able to wake up at 5 a.m., it ensures that I basically can shut off my computer by 6 p.m. What that really gives me is quality in real life time, which then I can actually spend with Olivia, which then also alleviates the abrasive energy, right? So between essentially meditation as well as quality time and couples therapy, I'm pretty confident that we can actually heal a lot of our relationship together. Finally, I drew a green arrow from feedback from my MindNation members to personal relationships with my members. This really matters to me because at the end of the day, the most rewarding aspects about being on social media and on YouTube is actually the personal relationships I'm able to build. So rather than looking at it as work and something that I have to do, this is actually something that I want to do. That framing is so, so important to actually lean into in truly enjoying what we actually like, what we actually are working on. Not only that, all the learnings that I glean from MindNation then allows me to provide more value for you guys here on YouTube. So that basically wraps up step number two. And at this point, I have a much better idea of how all of my different worries and different aspects of my life are connected. And we're ready to move on to the third and last step of crafting an action plan. For this last step, I actually like to draw a mirror mind map of the one that we just made. Essentially, we still have the question in the middle, as well as personal and professional. And I expand out all the different elements. However, as you'll notice that this map is far cleaner than this one that we came off of. And this is part of the distillation process that I was talking about. Because this one, all the red expansions are directly about actions. What makes this mind map an action plan is actually two things. One, you guessed it, is the actions that we can take for each of these areas. Number two is actually assigning a time frame, because it's not a plan until you actually know when you're going to execute on it. In that sense, I put here, learn how to use AI for creation. And I put here, assign this to one of my team members to actually research this month. Under Mind Map Nation, it's gathering feedback. So I've already sent out actually a bunch of surveys this week to them. So that's actually happening. Gather this week, gather information this week, and then implement some of the feedback within the next 4 weeks. And sometimes I don't really know. And if I don't have a particular time frame, for example, TikTok, I'm still trying to figure out, do I want to restart my account in order to gain more momentum? It's actually a question mark, and that's fine because it's not a high priority either right now. Going back here, which then I'm implementing over the next 4 weeks. And through the implementation process, I'll probably be able to learn more about what people want to see on the YouTube channel as well. So that's actually about analyzing the feedback and the ideas to improve the YouTube videos. Under Second Brain, I plan on finishing the Logseq course this week and then begin using it over the next 4 weeks to start building out my knowledge base. If I'm able to do that, then at the end of the 4 weeks, after my second brain is built and my content pipeline looks good and my team is solidified, I can begin working on the podcast. So there's a sequence in which that I'm taking these actions. If I really want to get fancy though, I could draw a linear timeline with all these different actions, or even put it into a Notion Kanban board, which I have actually gone through in a previous tutorial. So definitely check that out if you're interested. On the personal side, health-wise, I'm going to be implementing the new Mediterranean diet as well as meal prepping. Move, as I mentioned, 3 months timing. On the relationship side, this coming week, I've got couples therapy. I'm going to complete the birthday gift for Olivia and then spend quality time that is enabled by good routines, which is also actually starting up at the same time. What I notice about my routines is that my morning ritual, the 5 a.m. rise, you know, workout, cold shower and everything, gives me such a big boost in terms of productivity that actually really supports my professional endeavors. While my evening routine and rituals, which is no work after 6 p.m., that meditation and in bed by 10 p.m., really supports my relationships. So this is why routine actually deserved its own note or category to really pay attention to. At this point, I have a pretty solid game plan and time frame for addressing all the major areas of concern in my life. And that is the entire end-to-end process of mapping out our worries. Let me know in the comments below what parts of this video resonated with you, or if you have any questions. And if you found this video helpful, please hit that like or subscribe button because it helps me out a lot. And if you're ready to take your mind mapping to the next level, sign up to my newsletter Epiphany, or better yet, check out Mind Map Nation and take our 7-day Mind Map Mastery course. Alright guys, as always, thank you so much for watching, and until next time, take care.